I think I'm really in the film industry out of just total persistence. I think it's actually the only thing that mattered. I sort of started at the same time applying for funding with a lot of other people who were really quite talented, some I suspect who are more talented than me. And the but what happened is that, you know, we'd get turned down for funding. And in my case, I would be despairing about being turned down for funding, but I would forget about it like a day later, and then I'd just get on with applying again. And so I sort of think that, you know, some people after being rejected 3 times, they stopped applying. Some people it was 7, some people it was 12. I was on the verge of quitting after the 20th turn down, and I thought, well, actually, I'm not going to apply for short film funding anymore. Maybe what I should just do is write a feature, because long form stories don't freak me out, because I'm from, you know, a writing background and I've written long plays. And so I wrote Magik and Rose, and that was sort of great, because Larry had just started the no budget scheme, and everybody was really, like, there was a sort of industry feeling about how appalling it was to make films for this kind of low sum of money, and that people were going to be paid really badly, and they were paid really badly. I was paid really badly, but on the other hand, nobody really wanted to make them, so there wasn't very much competition for the funding. There was some, but, you know, it's not like people were banging down the doors to try and make their film for no money. I had a really good relationship with Larry Parr. Like, he, I mean, actually, I have a career because of Larry Parr. Because I'd had such a terrible run. And I mean, like, on 20 applications, I got shortlisted, and eventually you start, and I was a single mother, and, you know, trying to support myself. And so I was doing my master's at university at the same time, because I thought, I'm going to have to go teach in order to earn a living, and that this is never really going to work as a way. And then just out of, you know, I wrote that feature, and I went and saw Larry, and he said to me, oh no, I'll fund it. And I just thought, yeah, I've heard that before. And I don't think I really believed him until we got on the plane and flew to Hokitika for the location recce. And then I thought, oh, actually, he is going to do it. So Larry Parr is the reason I have a career, and the second reason is John Barnett. Because after I made Magik and Rose, and it would be interesting to know exactly what prompted John to do it, but I have a suspicion that is because he phoned me up and he asked me to come out and see him, and I thought it would be about writing or directing work, and he asked me if I wanted to produce this series that he was making called Being Eve. And I was like, what? Like, producer? And I said to him, you know, I'm not a producer. And he was like, yeah, no, you'll be great at it, and we'll help you. And, you know, we want somebody with a strong creative vision, because you really need that in television, because there's lots of different directors. And so, you know, like, in the end, I did it. But, you know, and I always think back, you know, what a crazy decision that he made. And I think that, you know, it was just a couple of things. I think it was really the fact that it was a show for teenage girls, where they were looking for kind of something new, and they'd gone through the process of kind of making a pilot, and they'd sort of looked at the pilot and gone, no, we need a younger woman. And at this, around the same time, at Sparta, I gave a talk about Magik and Rose's release. We released in the film festival, and we had this incredibly low budget. We had a $30,000 P&A, which is nothing. Like, it's completely nothing. And, you know, I'd spent 2 years of my life making it, and I knew that more than anyone, more than Larry, you know, who already had a kind of very stable career, that how it went would impact on me. We were coming out in the film festival, and because we had already screened in Hokitika, we ended up buried on page 78 of the booklet. So instead of, like, having any kind of featured premiere or anything, they counted our screening for the Hokitika Council as the premiere. So we decided to have a premiere, even though we were sort of not really featured in the festival. And so when I saw the booklet, I wept. Like, I wept. I just thought, after all of these years, like, to just come and, like, find yourself, like, way at the back on page 78. And then I got up the next day, and I thought, I can't just lie around crying about this. So I bought all the tickets. I bought every ticket to the premiere and to the screening at the festival, and I did a press release saying that it was the first film to sell out in the festival, and which was lunacy. Like, I don't even know what I was thinking. I was charged, like, I didn't have enough money to do it, so I charged the rest of it onto Larry Parr's credit card, and he was going to me, What if you can't sell them all? And I was going, of course I'm going to sell them all, right? So it's like thousands of dollars I charged up to this credit card, and I did sell them all. Essential Films, the distributor, bought some of the tickets because they wanted to comp the media because we hadn't had a media screening. So when I sent out the media comps, I got off Ticketek the map of the theater, and I marked in where the reviewers are, so I knew the Herald was sitting there, and then I gave the tickets around the reviewers to close personal friends and family. Don't mention that you know me. Talk about how great my film is. You're sitting next to the reviewer. It's true. It's absolutely true. It was the most manipulative, terrible thing. And then because of that, it started to sell really well in Wellington. And so we bought up the rest of the tickets in Wellington as well, and to make sure that it sold out early. And then by Christchurch, it just did it by itself. So I think John Barnett heard that story and went, oh, well, you know, maybe we can make her into a producer. So then I came and I did Being Eve, which I just had no idea what I was in for. Like, I used to have a weekly meeting with John Barnett that would go like this: I'm trying really hard to bring it back on schedule. I know we're doing something wrong, but I, you know, and actually he was really great to me. I think he was really pleased with the rushes and what we were doing, and he was incredibly supportive of the fact that there were things about it that weren't working, like in the kind of time money schedule. And he stuck with me and the people who were making it despite it. And in the end, we were nominated for an international Emmy. Came on board Outrageous Fortune because of Mike Smith. So Mike Smith was the producer of the original series, and so he employed me, and so there was me and the original two directors on it, and there are several across the series actually, but in the early meetings were me and Mark Beasley, and Mark Beasley was the head director, but they didn't want, so they wanted him to shoot first, but they didn't want to shoot episode 1 and 2 first, so I did 1 and 2. So it was a slightly strange process that you're, so it was lucky actually that I'd had the involvement with Mark from the start, and that I had a kind of, you know, I'd been involved in those kind of early discussions. And I mean, it's interesting actually, because, you know, episode 1 and 2 is always incredibly stressful to do, because it's the one that's going to be reviewed, and this was a reasonably big budget show. It was for, you know, a TV3 kind of prime time slot, so it was sort of the reverse of Being Eve, where Being Eve nobody expected it to really do well at all, and same with Magik and Rose. Like, so the first two things that I did were projects that had a total underdog status, and the beautiful thing about underdog status is that nobody bugs you. Like, no one bugs you. There's no like EPs phoning you up all the time, and like huge, like, there are stresses about getting it made that are being caused by you and maybe the things you're doing and the time, but it's not like endless interference. Whereas I think with primetime stuff, people get a lot more worried about it. And so my experience of Outrageous Fortune is that it was the first job that I did where it was just really stressful doing those episodes 1 and 2. So it's great that it went on and did so well, because I think that generically we were all so incredibly worried that, or that it did live up to the idea, because the idea is beautiful.